How he's doing it, you should do it.
What's going on, everybody? Welcome to T3G. I'm Haris.
Dalibor.
Man, today we are doing, so we did our
top 16 for 2016
video games. So we figure top 16 for 2016
movies.
Most anticipated movies to go see. Now, obviously, there's a lot of them. Yeah. There's obviously more than 16, but to fit in the 16,
it's a hard list to narrow down because there's so many great things coming out next year.
There's a lot.
So,
but then again, there was a lot this year too. So
there was, yeah,
there was. But so yeah, we're gonna go down the list. On you'll do yours first. I'll do mine second, and then
we're gonna have the discussion. We're gonna try to keep this under an hour and a half.
We'll keep it low, but. Yeah, go ahead and do yours first.
All right, so I got the list over here, doing a little cheat sheet. It's going to go basically in order of release. So Deadpool is my number one in order of release. I'm super psyched for this. I think it's going to be great. London Has Fallen. I really liked the first one, which is Olympus Has Fallen. I think the concept is interesting, so that'll be cool. Batman v Superman, nothing needs to be said there. My Big Fat Greek Wedding was one of my favorite movies of all time, so definitely number two has got to be on my list. Captain America Civil War, I'm super excited. I love the fact that somebody pointed out, I was watching somebody online, they pointed out that this is a personal Civil War. This is not Marvel Civil War, this is Captain America Civil War, and I love that. X-Men Apocalypse, I'm probably one of the biggest X-Men fans ever. Now You See Me 2, I love that first movie. I like magic movies, I think.
Yeah,
it's done good. It's a genre that's not represented a lot, but when it is, it's lately been done well. Prestige was great.
Prestige was really good.
Yeah,
I even like the Edward Norton
Illusionist.
I think
it was the Illusionist. Yeah. I didn't see that one, but I know I've heard. So
I've
many
watched
people
it.
Say
I
it's
liked
good.
It, and I liked Now You. I love Now You See Me in the first one.
And I think it was done really well, really grand extravagance, and everything was done super well.
Even though there are people out there that would disagree with us.
Right, I mean, lots of people. Yeah. Warcraft, of course, has to be on this list. This is going to be a huge year. I think this is going to be the year that decides if video game movies get made anymore. Between Warcraft and then my other item on here that's later in the year, I think that these are going to set the standard. If these movies do not,
I hope they do,
overperform, they have to overperform because to make up for all the bad, I say bad loosely because I like some of the other video game movies that have been made in the past, but they are not up to snuff anymore. They're not at the level and the quality that movies are coming out at.
Although I will say I did like The Prince of Persia with Jake Gyllenhaal. I don't know why.
But it made no money. And
I know, that's a damn shame.
I haven't seen it.
I played the first game and that, like, for story-wise was fairly...
Essentially the same thing.
So, you know, I just don't know what else people wanted. But,
about 20 years late, but still excited for
at least 20.
Independence Day resurgence. I love Independence Day. Anyone that wants to talk Independence Day with me, argue with me, I'm happy to do it. Nostalgia Critic, I hate you because your review, while true, is still annoying. That movie is freaking awesome. I love that movie. One movie that I know very little about is Knights of the Round Table, King Arthur. I'm a huge fan of Arthurian myth, legend, however you want to say it. It is probably one of my favorite periods in time. I love movies set around that era. I love movies that discuss and cover the Arthurian legend specifically. So that's absolutely got to be on my list. Guy Ritchie's doing it. There's very little information in an interview regarding what was the movie he did this year. Man from Uncle. So while he did an interview for Man from Uncle, I think the producer or the actor might actually also be in it. I forget who it was, the other person that was there. But they said that it's going to be taking place during the time that he's becoming king, how he becomes king. So they're going to narrow it down to really work out the characters, and so then it's not going to be this really long movie where like the rise and fall of King Arthur.
Because
that's usually how they do it when they do a King Arthur movie.
Right.
When they do the whole story. And you really have to rush through a few things.
Because the last one was with Clive Owen.
He
was Arthur. He was not Arthur yet. He was like on a mission to get somebody from one place to another safely.
And yeah.
So he wasn't like King Arthur yet. But he, I mean, obviously he was Arthur, but not King Arthur.
Yeah, so That was, again, I loved that.
Which actually, another, I enjoyed that movie.
Yeah, it was a great movie. I loved that. Excalibur's still one of my favorite movies.
Right.
First Night is a fantastic movie. Kind of cheesy these days when you watch it again, but still a great movie. The next movie is Star Trek Beyond. Again, I just...
Thank you, J.J. Abrams.
Yeah, absolutely.
even though you're not doing this one, right. Still, thanks.
Thanks for setting the bar, because I loved the first two. I know a lot of people didn't necessarily love the second one. I still enjoyed it thoroughly. I loved how, where we went into Spock's kind of persona more.
Yeah.
I actually was just telling Haris here that I'm going to rewatch... I just finished watching all of Star Trek, and I'm actually going to rewatch all of Star Trek.
Oh, my God.
In chronological order.
That's insane.
But now I found a lot of graphic novels that take place within that stuff, so I'm actually going to watch it and then read as well the stuff that takes place along the same timeline. So I'm probably going to take like 6 months next year, maybe probably leading up to this, to watch all of that, right. Reread it all. The next one on my list is Suicide Squad. I am super hyped about this movie. I loved what Marvel did with Guardians, taking this really unknown team and really kind of shoving it down our throats and super, like, really well. It was, you know, it was creamy, it was delicious, right seasonings. Everything was great. And I think that movie was great. I think this is going to be a great movie. We'll have this discussion later, but yeah. I love that movie. I love the concept of that movie. I think it's going to be great. The Magnificent Seven. I could never say no to Denzel Washington. Denzel Washington can make a movie about him, like, talking to someone in a, like, black room with nothing else happening. Well, I would go see that movie opening day. I love Denzel Washington.
Well, people made fun of his role. You know, there was a lot of sketches, of comedy sketches, of his role in Flight Plan. And that was a good movie. Right? Flight Plan?
Yeah.
Flight? Where he's a drunk pilot?
Yeah. I don't think it was Flight Plan. I think Flight Plan's a different movie. Maybe. I don't know.
I can't remember. Well, but you guys know what we're talking about. They made fun of his role in that, and I'm like, but it was Denzel. Like, yeah. It was like, Denzel is never...
There's never a movie where Denzel's in it where he's not Denzel. Like, right. Where he's phoning it in. Although, I've seen lots of movies where people go and they phone it, like, let's not talk about, you know, the ruination of 2015, but... There's a lot of movies that come out people just go in and they're like, I'm going to collect my paycheck. I'm going to show up, do an end job, and it's going to be an end movie, but I'm going to collect my paycheck.
I know this is top 16, but my favorite, I would say my favorite of his movies is Man on Fire. I love that movie.
You know what's messed up? I still haven't finished that movie because the copy I had was bootleg. And this is why you don't get bootleg movies, children.
Or anything, really, because it never works right.
Right. It literally broke apart. So, and I was like, midway through the movie. And I'm just like, but no.
I don't know what happens.
So I actually never went back to finish it, but everything I saw was great. And then the next movie... has to be on this list. Doctor Strange. If you haven't seen the animated movie of Doctor Strange, please go buy that. It's probably at a Half Price Books or some used movie store near you for like $7. It's a great animated movie.
And from what I understand...
anything close to that...
Well, from what I understand, they're actually pulling a good amount from that. They're doing it very close to that story.
From what I've seen from the little still images of...
Because it's the same concept. Like, he gets an axe and breaks his hand.
I mean, that's the origin. It's one of the best origins in comics.
Sure.
Because he was this jerk.
Right.
He starts off as a jerk. And very few characters start off as, like, visually, like, they know they're an asshole. Sure. They're going to continue being an asshole. And just, like, this one thing that forces them to not be an asshole.
Right.
This is one of the only characters that I know of that starts that way. And he goes into being, like, a really redeemed, excellent character. So I'm super excited about that. And the next movie that's on the list here for me is the other movie that we're going to be looking at this year to see the future of video game movies is Assassin's Creed. This movie has had some tumultuous times
set up. Anything, Fassbender is really attached to this project.
Oh, yeah. Fassbender is one of the greatest actors out today.
Yeah, absolutely. And if he's attached to it so much that he's willing to watch bad things happen during the process of this movie and work with it.
Mm-hmm.
Then I have some hope for it because
depending on how they approach it, if they approach it from that kind of two time period thing,
right?
I think it's going to be interesting, but I think that might lose people. It would be, I think, maybe to their advantage to just focus on the assassin story. Kind of skip the other portion of it.
Right.
I think you could work it in. I think it could be done well. But I think it once would, you do that, it starts getting
it does,
into that really kind of weird stuff that it it's does, sci-fi. But
they should really do it, because I think it would, to have a little bit of that thinking aspect to a what basically would be a comic book movie, basically.
Right, I mean, essentially.
It's just a video game movie. Yeah, same concept. It would be just a fun action visual movie. I think for it to have that thinking aspect to it, they should include the entire story. I think it would be smart. Now, obviously, I'm not talking about the entire story. This definitely has to be multiple movie story.
This has to be
the there first. Is way too much
you
story.
You can't do this except for the first movie.
Yeah.
You can do this. Assassin's Creed can only be the first game.
Yeah, no.
This can't be anything else except the first
game. Yeah, you absolutely cannot.
You can maybe throw in some of the like graphic novel portions of it.
If they do what Shyamalama Ding Dong, whatever his name is, did with The Last Airbender, where he fit, he basically made it suck.
He fit 30.
He fit the
so like
first
hours.
Book. He
15
fit the,
hours.
He fit
or
the
so.
First book, but he tried to do it in under 2 hours.
He essentially
that
he,
movie
he
needed to be 3 hours.
Essentially,
it needed
essentially
to be.
He took about 15 hours of content
and
story
he
shoved it into an
somehow
hour
messed up visuals in the time where visuals were just becoming amazing, and he still just completely like.
I think they were okay. I don't think the visuals is what really brought that movie down.
But that wasn't the only thing.
I think
just the whole...
A whole lot of things.
But that's a whole
that
different story.
Down.
So yeah, this and movie just... They need to make sure not to try to cramp a lot of things in one movie and make it
take
a proper length.
Listen,
if it needs to be 2.5 hours, make it 2.5 hours. People will
exactly.
be fine with that as long as the pace is good and the acting's good and the story makes sense.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
You can execute a longer movie. I mean, you look at the Lord of the Rings movies, the Hobbit movies,
yeah.
you can execute a longer movie.
What are the 3 hours?
And people won't care. You can execute a short movie, and if you do it poorly, it feels like it's forever.
Yeah.
You look at, again, The Abomination
Which
of 2015.
Yeah,
we'll link that. But I think you can do this movie, make it one movie, make it the first game, make it the first story. You know, obviously you're going to have to cut it down. That's like 7 hours of storyline.
And obviously
movie,
they're not going to go
game.
Exactly the same
it's
because
not gonna go
it's,
one
never
for one.
Go, it's never going
to
be that
But don't
way.
Try to put more than you have to in the movie. Listen, if it fails, it fails. You didn't try to like shove a ton of stuff into it.
That's
you did
I'm
your
saying,
best
right.
job. If it does well,
because
franchise
did,
the hell out of it.
Because
give me
you
12
did your
of
best
them.
Job.
I don't care.
Right, because you did your best job and it does well, perfect. But if you've done literally your best job and it doesn't do well, well, listen, at least at the end of the day, you can be like, you know what? We did everything we
and
could.
And this is one of those things that if you franchise it,
right,
every movie's going to have a different actor.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to be fantastic because every movie, you could use new unknown actors.
The only thing they would have to keep consistent is the future, because they always go back to the future.
Right.
You always
see
the future.
And here's the thing. If you plan on if this one does well, when you film the next one, just film all the scenes for all the future stuff for the next one.
Yeah,
and just like cut that stuff in. Like, oh, I know like you're only doing like 6 months of work, but we're just gonna record stuff for the next 7 movies.
Yeah.
If we make only 3, we make only 3, but we're gonna record for 7 right. movies. And the last movie on my list is Jumanji. If you haven't seen the original Jumanji, let me rephrase that. If you don't love the original Jumanji, I don't like you. We can't be friends. That movie's great. The movie's hilarious.
Yeah, we can't be friends.
That movie's
no,
so
is a
fun.
Great movie. That
it's
is a
so
great movie.
So ridiculously fun. And one of the not so greatest 90s cartoons,
mm-hmm.
but it spawned an entertaining cartoon for the
right.
90s. I am super excited to see how this plays out with the new graphics. I'm mind boggling excited because this is going to be super
awesome. You should be.
So that's my top 16 for 2016 anticipated movies. And now, go for it.
All right, so first off, no particular order. I will give my top 1 and 2. But that's all I know is my top 1 and 2. I don't know what the rest of that order is. But otherwise, it will be going in no particular order. And I will do honorable mentions that are actually on his list, which is Jumanji, Suicide Squad, Now You See Me 2, and, well, London Has Fallen, because I did enjoy it. And Independence Day, of course, because, I mean, we loved it. We loved the first one. So, all right. So, first starting off, once again, I will say when 1 and 2 are up. But the first starting off, we're going to do Assassin's Creed. As everything we've said, as long as they do everything right, you know, if they do their best,
yeah,
that's all you have to do. Just do your best. I love the first one, so I know there's a lot of controversy on some people not liking it, as a lot of other people, or some people not liking it at all. But I loved Jack Reacher, so Jack Reacher 2, of course, is on my list. I am a huge fan of Bourne. That, listen, the Jeremy Renner Bourne was, it was good. It was good, but it wasn't the original trilogy, nowhere near it. And
I didn't see that one.
Yeah, and I'm excited for Bourne 5 because Matt Damon and the director, which I'm escaping my mind of the
name. You got to feel bad for Jeremy Renner, though, because he didn't get a franchise out of it.
Well, it's not that he even didn't get a franchise out of it, but he didn't even get called in to be like, hey, we could kind of like throw you in to blend right, you with Bourne. Because it was still technically in Bourne. It's not like this was 30 years after Bourne or something. It was still in Bourne universe. So, like, they could have had two pretty good stars. Because
he didn't get that, and then Tom Cruise decided to stay on Mission Impossible, so he didn't get that either.
Right. So, we'll see if he comes back for the next one. So, going after that, as we said, J.J. Abrams, thank you very much for what you've done for the series. Star Trek Beyond, super excited. I love the first two. I watched some of the shows. I've never watched the entire series of any one of the shows, but I loved everything that I've seen of Star Trek. So I loved the first two movies when they redid them. That was awesome. I mean, J.J. Abrams just, he brought an audience that would have probably never watched Star Trek to Star Trek.
Yeah, absolutely.
And thank you for that. Absolutely. Because he made everything exciting.
He made, like, the slowest stuff from the shows, which was, like, the walks through the corridor.
Yeah.
Every single walk through a corridor in that movie
was
exciting.
Yeah,
it was super exciting. When Chekhov was like, I can do this.
Right?
And just, like, gunning. And I'm like, this is freaking awesome.
Absolutely, absolutely. So, I mean, when you bring that kind of excitement and entertainment to a series that most people or a good chunk of people would have not cared for, good on you. So thank you for doing that, and I am super excited. Even though you're not doing it, I'm excited for that, for number 3. Next one.
I'm excited to see the trailer during Star Wars.
I'm saying, which we got to go get the tickets like now.
Yeah.
By the way, our theaters are not sold out in any fashion.
If you're going to be visiting Chicago, you can see it opening night. Yeah, you can probably get tickets that day.
You can get probably Star Wars tickets that day. Next one, just like you. Huge fan of King Arthur, so of course Knights of the Round Table. As I said, I like the last one they did. Unfortunately, apparently didn't do good enough to get anything else from that. So keep bringing them. I'll watch one every year, to be honest. I don't care if it's different actors every time.
I'll take a different
I don't care if it's the same story, different approach every time.
Yeah, I'll take a different interpretation.
I'm a huge fan of King Arthur.
Because that's the thing. That's the great thing about Arthurian legend. There's so many different tales. There's some versions where, you know, he's just a kid, and he's born, and he gets the sword.
Sure.
Some versions where he literally is formed out of the ocean.
Yeah.
So, there's different takes on the story already. So, yeah, give me 100 different takes. I don't care.
Absolutely. Next one, Warcraft. I say World of Warcraft because that's what I play. But Warcraft, as Assassin's Creed, I enjoyed the trailer. I watched the trailer. Obviously, we both did. I enjoyed it. I was happy with it. Visually looks great.
Yeah.
I don't know what anybody's talking about. The orcs look awesome. Like, they need to be the mix between human and monster, and I think that was done perfectly. Like,
I think it's done well.
Yeah.
I think it's done well. The guy who is it the guy who played Doom?
He sure is in the Abomination. In the Abomination of Abominations. So listen, I'm excited for it. I think that is the movie that is going to change movies for gaming movies. I think that's the movie.
Yeah.
I think that is that coming out before Assassin's Creed?
Yeah, yeah. Mine was in order of release.
Right.
Warcraft is in July.
So I think that they're going to do it. I think with Warcraft, they're going to change it as a summer
blockbuster.
Yeah.
It doesn't really have competition.
Right.
Like, everything's already done by that point. X-Men Apocalypse, I think, comes out at least
At least
2 or 3 weeks before that.
Yeah, Captain America's before that.
Like, it doesn't have any direct competition. It might, I think, stomp on Independence Day. I don't remember if Independence Day comes out super close after it. But it's one of those things that I think Warcraft is going to do fantastic.
I think they're going to do a great job. I think the movie's going to bring in money. I think the trailer definitely... I think it does it justice.
I want them to keep rendering to like the last week.
Yeah, absolutely. Before this absolutely. Sunday. Just keep doing what you guys are doing. Listen, the director, he might be new, but he's done some great stuff. Moon, if you have not watched it, watch Moon.
There was a lot of concern because he hasn't done a major summer blockbuster.
Yeah,
kind
but
of thing.
watch the stuff he's done, and you'll see. And plus, on top of that, he's a huge fan of Warcraft and World of Warcraft. Yep. So that's always a good thing. Next one, I'm a Turtles fan always and forever, and I love the first Turtles movie, even though them trying to say that. Saying that I love the Turtles, now I can't remember the reporter's name.
Bro!
I can't believe it. Bro. That it's blanking on
April
me.
Right? April
O'Neil, thank you. I was gonna say her real name, Megan Fox.
April O'Thumbs.
But the fact that they were gonna... they integrated April O'Neil as... Like, she knew the Turtles from the beginning. You know, she was technically their master... You know, because...
She was their owner, yeah.
She was their owner. That was, you know, whatever. It didn't bother me. But the fact that...
It wasn't necessary,
wasn't necessary, but, you know, whatever. But overall, the movie reminded me of the animated series from the 90s.
Yeah, it was super fun.
80s, 90s,
it was super
late
fun.
80s, early 90s.
It was an entertaining movie. I think it was way better than people gave it credit for.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I think it should have made more money.
I think there's a lot of these... I think there's a lot of these purists out there that are like, oh, man, the movie was awful. But I don't know what they're going off of. You look at somebody like John Schnepp, who, I'll be honest, I love the dude, but I disagree with him on a lot of things. He's talking about, like, he thought it was an entertaining movie. Yeah. He's never seen Turtles.
Right.
It was outside of his time frame. He was already, more grown up that when that came out.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
He's never seen it. So when he went to see the movie, he went to see it with nothing, like no impression to begin with. So he had a good time. And I'm like, that's what you got to go in with. Yeah. You can't go into these movies that are based on things and be like, well, this is what the source material is, and you just walk in, comparing scene for scene. Like, well, that's not source material.
Oh, my God.
I hate
Could you imagine? We would hate everything.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
We would hate
everything. That's the thing. That's why everybody hates on the third X-Men movie, especially. But, like, that's the thing. A lot of that stuff, a lot of these scenes that are in X3 mm-hmm. are scenes from the comics.
Right, I got you.
And people are just like, that movie's awful. No, whereas, like, he, when he went in from the few...
But when you say it's awful, like, you know how I do. I base it off a lot of things. Well, the actors are the same, so you know the acting's the same, so that's not awful.
Right. I thought he did the best Storm out of the three movies.
Right. The script is good. I mean, what they said verbally didn't sound corny, didn't sound cheesy, didn't sound stupid. So they spoke like they spoke in any other movie. Like, they spoke
I think it was a good movie.
Like, so it's like, that's kind of things. Like, when you say something's awful or something's bad, you gotta have more than be like, it wasn't what I remember.
Right, that's the thing I remember. But a lot of these people...
It'll never be.
A lot of these movies that are being made are being, you know, remakes. My wife just said, why they keep remaking remakes?
Because
Hollywood has no original ideas anymore. Any movie you see is either a rehash of somebody else's idea or a combination of multiple ideas.
Although, Campia will argue with you that in 2015 alone, or not 2014 alone, there's been more original movies than ever in history of filmmaking.
I'll have to look at that list. I'll make that decision.
I'll make that decision. All right, so going from, once again, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Half Shell is what they're calling it. I'm excited, happy, can't wait.
Half Shelf.
Next movie, X-Men Apocalypse. Listen, everybody was going crazy about how Apocalypse looks. Then they showed a new rendering of Apocalypse, which makes him look even closer to the Apocalypse. Yes, I'm not going to disagree. He looked like Ivan Ooze from the Mighty Morphin
Power
Rangers.
But here's the thing, to me, I don't care. I like that movie.
Yeah, but I like it. I like it, so I didn't give a crap. But he looks better. Guys, like, you need to calm down. What they show you is nowhere near the final product. So they have time to adjust everything.
Who cares?
But that's the other thing.
You're going to tell me that that's the problem you had with that movie? Yes, it's called Apocalypse, so Apocalypse should be the best thing. Dude, you have Storm, which is a 1-to-1 from the 80s. You have
Jubilee.
Psylocke, which is a 1-to-1 from the 80s.
Jubilee is literally...
Jubilee is perfection on screen. I'm saying. Dude, you can't even give me this nonsense.
No, it's fine. It's fine.
Oh, he doesn't look perfect.
It's fine.
Dude, A, if you're actually going to use Apocalypse's powers, he shapeshifts. So 90% of the time, you're not even going to look at that guy.
Right. So regardless, listen, X-Men Apocalypse, I'm excited for it. Once again, if you see the new renderings, he looks closer to Apocalypse. From what I understand, the ones that were actually official was real.
Oh, okay.
The next one on my list, Snowden. I'm a huge JGL fan, so I like to see the story of Snowden. Maybe some things that I might have not known from the actual facts that were there. Maybe they'll show it that will, you know, maybe surprise me some more. But I'm a huge JGL fan, so whatever he does, I want to see it. I want to support the guy.
Yeah.
Give him his chance. So I'm excited for that movie. I do want to see that movie. The next one, not a lot of people enjoy the first one. Some people did. Some people, very rare, very little people actually could say that they loved it. I enjoyed it quite a lot. I would say it's a really good movie. I wouldn't say it's great or phenomenal or anything, but I think it's a really good movie. And I'm excited for The Huntsman. I think The Huntsman, Winter's War, is going to be a really good movie. Now, granted, you're eliminating the thing that was bad about the first one, which is... Kristen Stewart. Offense to Kristen Stewart, but her acting chops.
I'll be the first one to say...
Although I enjoyed her in that and more than anything else I've seen her in. So
as soon as she does a movie where she does a good job, I'll be the first to say that she did a good job.
Right.
Don't get me wrong. I'll give anybody a shot. But listen, I'm one of the 17 men on the planet that'll admit to seeing most of the Twilight movies.
Right.
And, bro, this movie sucked, A.
Yeah.
B, she is not a good actress in those movies. I don't know. Well, rephrase that at least. Maybe she's not a bad actress. Maybe that's how it's all written, and they're just like player flat. We just want no emotions, no right. actual discernible human qualities.
Yeah.
So maybe that's what they told her, and that's what she played. And then maybe she's a great freaking actress.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
But I don't know, because to me it just looked like a flat character with no emotions.
Right. No.
But anyway.
But
I think this movie will be better without her. I think you have the core element of what that movie.
Yeah.
The good things about that movie, you have the Huntsman, you have him, and you have.
I can't think of her name.
The Queen, who is back to life because of her sister, the Ice Queen.
Well, from my understanding, this is a prequel too.
No.
Oh, it's not?
So the first half is a prequel.
Oh, okay.
So like the first half is
right because they're young, right?
Right, because they're young, they come up, and then
afterwards.
Then she finds out that she's dead, and she brings her back to life.
Why can I remember her name? She was in Hancock. She was in Fury Road.
Bing. Go to the next one.
Whatever, Chris Hemsworth. Her, there's actually a lot of big actors in this, and I'm excited for it. I like Chris Hemsworth in everything he's done so far. I even like Red Dawn, which a lot of people were mad that it got remade, but I enjoyed him in Red Dawn. So I'm a huge fan, and I can't wait to see it. Next one, listen, I'm gonna mispronounce his last name because I always do, but John Favre. The director of Iron Man.
Favreau.
Thank you.
I was like, what?
Yeah, I always mispronounce his last name. He is a good actor, a great director, and after seeing the trailer for that, yes, I'm excited. Period. There's nothing else I have to say. If you haven't watched
the title.
The Jungle Book. The Jungle Book.
I'm like...
The Jungle Book. I thought I did. Slipped my mind. I'm just watching the trailer. Everybody listen, I watched whoever got a chance to go to Disney's little showcase. I watched the reactions and everybody was talking about the Jungle Book. And I'm like, it couldn't have been that good. But then they were like, just so you know, everything you're about to see is green screen. They said like 90% of that movie is green screen.
Oh, yeah, it has to be.
90% of the movie is green screen.
I mean, it's wild.
But
animals.
When you see it, you would not think that's green screen.
No, but here's the thing. Disney is one of the most powerful corporations on the planet. So they have the money to pay the people to make the best stuff. Right. So the fact that it's great is not surprising to me. Although the Good Dinosaur failed.
The Good Dinosaur didn't do so.
But that's Pixar, even though
they own it.
Yeah, but anyway, I think visually it has to be stunning because it's Disney. It's they're doing it on their version, so from their animated movie.
You've never cared for the Jungle Book.
I'm not a huge fan of that story, so I've never really grasped onto me. I feel like to me, that is more. It's almost like that Lost Boy story.
Obviously, Tarzan. He grew up in the wild.
Yeah.
Lost Boy in the wild.
Yeah. Grew up in the wild. And just none of that to me, eh. No. I read Zenoscope's version is way more interesting to me.
Sure.
Because it's multiple kids and there's a whole other dynamic. So to me, that's way more interesting where it's just this one kid and I'm just I know Tarzan, this is the same story.
Yeah, yeah. No, absolutely. But that being said, visually it's amazing. I just watching the trailer, I was I can't wait. And it's not just because of visuals. It's just how the boy was reacting to the CGI animals, the way the animals were in front of you, it was absolutely
right. So
amazing.
Think about this image and think about how Shia LaBeouf had to react to basically this just hand puppet of Optimus Prime's head. And now think if everything in your environment was that.
Right.
And for you to still do a great job.
I'm saying.
To just voices being played.
Yeah, or maybe voices absolutely. Being played. Absolutely. So that's that. I don't really have any much more to say to that. You should go see it, by the way. just for the sake of seeing it and helping them out. I mean, it's not like Disney needs money, but that being said. The next one, honestly, didn't know much about it, but then when I watched the trailer and stuff like that, I just lost my mind, and it's definitely one of those movies that's outside of the norm of what this list is, which is visually fun, adventure, slash comic book, slash gaming
movies.
That's what it is. This, 999, holy crap. First of all, the cast, wow.
Ridiculous cast.
Wow. I'm hoping this is not one of those movies where it's a ridiculous cast and people don't like it because it was a bad movie somehow with this ridiculous cast. Because there was a few movies that had a ridiculous cast and they turned out apparently to be bad. But this, I don't know. That trailer sold me.
It looks great. Woody Harrelson's fantastic. I want to see anything in Woody Harrelson.
Yeah.
I think this definitely makes my honorable mentions list.
Yeah, absolutely.
I didn't know anything about it until he played a trailer for it about an hour ago. I think it looks good. I'm definitely going to see it. To me, I don't know, the way I structure my list is something that, to me, is day one, got to see it. And this, to me, I definitely want to see it. If I don't make, day one, week one, I won't be mad.
Right.
Whereas, things along the lines, we're going to see Star Wars next week. That's next week. We're going to see Star Wars next week.
I feel like it was yesterday was a year ago when we were talking about J.J. Abrams doing Star Wars.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's like, wow.
So, we're going to see Star Wars next week. And, that's something where I was genuinely, when everybody was, we hadn't actually checked, but when everybody was talking about, all the theaters, all the showings,
everybody
on the internet, because everybody is from L.A.
Los Angeles.
So, everybody's it's all sold out. And I'm like, man, I'm going to be mad if I'm, I got to wait till January 15th to see it, because everybody's, but no, out here, we're good.
Plenty.
So we're going to be seeing it opening night, because it's one of those things that I would have genuinely been mad about not seeing super early
on. I got you. For me, I don't know. I just, I like movies outside what the norm is right now. The norm is, let's be serious, comic book movies or something like it, right? That's the norm.
Yeah, sci-fi,
that's what makes money. That's what makes money. That's what's the hit in the theater. So for me, for a movie that's outside of that norm to really catch my eyeballs,
it's got to be Oscar material.
Yeah. This trailer did it.
For this to do exceptionally well, I think it has to be Oscar material. So, look at even this year. What's kind of the biggest movie of the year? The Martian, sci-fi.
Yeah.
It's going to be hard to get away from this, from that genre, because I think less people, because this is a movie about dirty cops.
Yeah.
To say very generally, the trailer is way deeper than that. So I imagine the movie's way deeper than that. But from what I can tell, this is a movie about basically dirty cops and the cops in inner city.
Right.
And that's like super, super close to home right now. With everything going on, with all these police shootings and everything like that, that's super close to home. Fewer people are going to go see that. I mean, that's just like facts.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
Fewer people are going to go see that. Absolutely. Way more people want to see something that's just going to take them 100% away from their life, 100% away from their problems and family and issues and everything. It's going to be like, I'm going to sit here for the next 90 to 120 minutes, and I'm going to be in space. Yeah. I'm going to be somewhere else, and yeah. I'm going to be nowhere near having to go home and watch people and children get killed on TV.
No, absolutely.
So, like, that's the thing is, this kind of movie, well, I think is going to be amazing. I think these kinds of movies do definitely serve a purpose in society, and people need to watch them. And people need to be aware of these kinds of things. I think it's just not going to make as much money. It just it'll have to be super high caliber Oscar material.
Right.
Like, it'll have to be Training Day for 2015.
Yeah, and I mean, I truly hope I hope it makes anywhere between total 50 maybe to 100 million. I hope
total run.
Yeah.
I would give it an opening. Now we're getting another guess.
I know.
And that movie's coming out like May.
Yeah.
Something like that. I would say opening weekend, that stuff. Depending on.
I'm not saying opening weekend. I'm talking about total run.
Total. You're hoping.
Anywhere between 50 to 100.
So you're saying 50 to 100.
Because let's be serious.
I would give it a solid like 60 mil. To 75 mil total.
Let's be serious. With the how many actors are in there, they probably spend 25 mil. Okay? Because let's...
To make the whole thing, yeah. I would say their budget's probably under 40.
Yeah, it's probably 25, 30 mil. I've never seen a movie like those kind of movies that are that expensive, right?
So exactly.
It's 25, 30 mil. So I'm hoping it makes anywhere between 50 to 100. Closer to the 100, but we'll see. I mean, like you said, I mean, the only thing that's... came out recent that's made good money and that wasn't the norm was Straight Outta Compton.
And even that has a lot of flack.
It does have a flack, yeah,
because
absolutely.
Because they really watered it down.
They did, yeah, absolutely.
They removed a lot of the situations that people don't want to talk about.
Right.
So, but anyway.
But anyway, that being said, I'm really excited. Take a look at the trailer. We can probably leave all the trailers in the description. Or at least all the ones that we can find. I know some of them clearly don't have trailers yet. The next one, of course, has to be on the list. Doctor Strange, Benedict Cumberbatch, or as the Cumberbitches say, that's his thing. That's his thing. They're Cumberbitches. That's who they are. Listen.
That just sounds like a super dirty word.
I know, right? But I'm a huge fan of Benedict from just purely from Sherlock. But then obviously being Khan in the second Star Trek
Sherlock
movie.
Is one of the best representations of Sherlock Holmes, I think, ever.
Yeah, and it's set in modern time, which is awesome. Now, don't get me wrong, Elementary is too.
Super excited about the really special, good. Though.
Yeah, I'm super, super excited about the special because it's in the old days. I want to see how they do it. It's going to be great.
Yeah.
But him as Doctor Strange, listen, he's a nerd through and through. He really is. I mean, he's cosplayed as Spike. Literally, from Cowboy Bebop. He's cosplayed as Spike.
That's awesome.
So, like, this guy is a nerd. Who better to play a character out of the comics than a guy that enjoys that kind of stuff, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
So, I can't wait. He's a great actor. You can't say that he's not. Even if you haven't seen him in a lot of things, he is a great actor. He mm-hmm. truly is. He's definitely one of the better actors that are out now, if not one of the best. So,
yeah.
There's really not much else to say. Plus, it's Marvel, so that's that. Obviously, next one following the tread, Captain America Civil War. I love the last Captain America. Winter Soldier was amazing. And that's a lot to be said, considering I wasn't a huge fan of the first Captain America. Remember when the first Captain America came out and I said Planet of the Apes was better?
And I was like,
you're
bro.
Like, get out of here.
Bro,
then he saw it.
You're
it's
crazy.
Like, you're right.
I was like, you're crazy, you're insane.
And then saw.
And I called him after I saw the original Planet of the Apes, the first one rather, not the original. All
right.
And I'm like, I won't say that it's better, but it definitely is good.
So, I wasn't a huge fan. Not saying that the first Captain America was bad, don't get me wrong, I don't think it was bad. I just, out of all their movies that were out at that time, that was my lowest ranking one for them, but that's still a good movie. So the fact that Winter Soldier blew it away for me, I was like, wow, this was just a great movie, because it had, it had your thinking aspect, it had the betrayals and stuff like that from the government, seeing what Steve Rogers goes through trying to, fight this corruption, and then all the action sequences were just amazing, watching the parkour from Captain America, watching the action scenes, I think it was just so much more there than it was from the first one, and they knocked it out of the park. I can only imagine what Civil War is going to be like. I mean, we saw in the trailer, we saw the fight between Iron Man, Captain America, and Bucky Barnes. And, dude, the way Cap and Bucky are fighting together against Iron Man was awesome. Here's the thing. Awesome.
It's a great scene. Oh, and that's my God. Great concept. I'm not a huge fan of that moment, strictly because it plays like they fought together,
right? But they have
not like
but
this. Not like not, that. Not with powers, not with strength, not with the shield.
And I mean, I can't believe that Bucky already has his memory back so much that he's like, "Hey, I remember you. We were homies. I know how we played together, how we did things together." So I can't. Even though the scene's awesome, I agree.
I just want to see him do.
But listen,
giant arm, and be like, "Oh, we were homies."
I'm firmly believing that it's not going to be. It's not going to be the Civil War we all know from the comics.
No.
It's going to have the similar, obviously, aspect of, one's for the, Registration Act, one's not. Obviously, that part of it is going to be the same. But when it comes down to the caliber of mutants that are going to be in there, the amount of... It's going to be Cap and Iron Man and very little of anybody else. Let's be serious. You know what I'm saying?
Here's the
like,
thing.
We're going to see Black Panther.
Yeah.
But I bet you, even they say, like, he's Spider-Man in this movie. He's going to be like, I don't know which role I'm going to take, right?
And
at the same time, he's, like, probably going to be like, listen, I'm new to this. I got my own country to worry about.
They said that he's going to have a very personal stake
right,
in
exactly.
it. So he's got his own motivation. Right. He's not there to side with one or the other. He has his own, his own motivation. I think somebody brought this up. We watch a lot of YouTube, guys.
Yeah, of course.
Somebody on YouTube brought up that if you look at the three movies as a trilogy, as a separate trilogy, the first one, he was, the spokesmodel, the spokesman for the government, for the military. Mm-hmm. And the second one, the military turned out to be bad guys.
Yep.
So, definitely falling out with the government.
Yep.
And the third one, he's literally breaking away from the government. And... On the other side, somebody else that I was watching brought up that, they dropped the Sokovia Accords,
right.
Which is obviously in relation to what happened with Ultron.
Sure.
And then on top of that, what's going to happen in this one, mm-hmm. I think what's great about it is that, you have this overarching thing. It's a UN initiative,
sure.
So it's a global issue.
Right, it's global.
American registration.
Sure.
This is a global thing. So
because it was heroes from America that went to a different complete country,
yeah.
So and they were like, listen, we're taking care of this business, but I mean, technically, it wasn't your business. In technicality.
Technicality, yes.
So, yeah, like you were doing
except
things,
for Thor doesn't really have a nationality.
Right, well, Thor's like, nah, I'm Asgardian, screw you all.
But there's that, and there's, I think, the really cool aspect that it's going to be very personal because it's, you have this, the accords
right.
that they're going to have to deal with, and that's going to be a debate they're going to have.
Right.
But then on top of that, you have, also, we're going after your buddy.
Sure.
And they're like, well, I got to protect my friend.
Right.
And that's where the conflict comes in. The conflict comes in more so, I think, because of the friendships, and not because of
I think that's the biggest thing. I think that's the biggest thing.
I mean, the accords are going to be like the room you're in, but the actual stuff in the room.
I was telling you that when we watched the trailer. It looks like it's more focused around the friendship aspect of
friendship and
more
betrayal.
More that than anything else.
Some of the strongest concepts in storytelling is friendship and betrayal.
Just finishing off on Captain America, I will say we both agree that we don't see how Tony fits on the side of the government. Because every Tony's telling in the movie so far, he hates the government. He's completely against them. He's like, no, you can't have my armor. No, I will not give you my weapons. Like,
right. It's not even that he hates the government. It's that he's very much intent on remaining independent.
Right.
And... To see him, especially to see Tony Stark, especially somebody coming. The only thing I can think of is coming out of Ultron, that he has this guilt about him.
Sure.
Of like, listen, like no one like reined me in. I just kind of went on my own.
There needs to be a little explanation on why he's doing that because it doesn't make sense.
Because otherwise, Tony Stark is somebody who always wants to do his own thing in his own way. So to be like, I'm totally for somebody telling me how to do my thing.
Right.
It's a stretch for me, so I'm gonna need that explanation.
So that part of the list was, like I said, no specific order. No, it wasn't my, you know, that was like 10 through 8 or anything like that. It's just no specific order. Now these two are my top two. Number two, the spot for number two, most anticipated for next year, Deadpool. That's because I've been waiting for it since Ryan Reynolds been waiting for it. Period.
10 years.
Yeah. Yeah. 10 years. Ten years.
Nine, ten years.
He was the perfect guy to do it. One, because he is that character. Literally. In real life. That is who he is.
That's his personality.
That is, like you said, his personality. He talks exactly
And that was his argument. Back when Wizard Magazine was still a thing, which is at least 4 years ago. He did an interview with them. I think this was regarding when Origins came out.
Yeah.
And they're like, no, I really want to do this movie. And they're like, you know, why? Like, what really speaks about... What speaks to you about the character of Deadpool? He's like, he's the merc with a mouth. I don't think I need to explain that anymore.
Yeah. Like, literally, that is who he is. Plus, on top of that, being a huge fan of the comics of Deadpool, since he was a kid, he's done nothing but read this guy... From beginning to end, he's always said that. So he has a very close connection, obviously, on top of that being the merc with the mouth. So number two, most anticipated. I cannot wait. I'm hopefully.
I hope it does. I want seven of these.
Listen, I hope I have enough money to see it 10 times in the theater.
Agreed.
Regular price.
Yeah, full price.
Full price. Just that's how much I want to support it. And of course, number one... This movie, everybody and their mom has been waiting for this movie to happen. Not because they're comic book fans, but just because they know who these characters are.
Yeah, they've been waiting for this movie.
And not necessarily the fact that it's Batman v Superman, just Batman and Superman in one movie.
On the same screen.
On the same screen at the same time. Listen, me and him both agree. The only thing that we have to see for Batman v Superman, for the V part, for Batman against Superman, is what we saw in the animated movie from the animated series. They throw each other around in a club real quick. Superman peeks with his x-ray, says, Bruce? And he's like, you peeked. And Batman follows him back to his place with a tracer that he didn't realize he put on him. And he's like, gotcha. Done. That is all I have to see. The rest of the movie, give me everything else that has to deal with Lex Luthor and Doomsday. Because I do not need to see more about Batman v Superman. I get it. Batman's got a problem. There's an alien on Earth. He can literally destroy the planet if he felt like it. He caused some problems. But it technically wasn't his fault. He didn't decide to bring aliens to the planet. He was trying to figure out how he was an alien.
This is just a wild guess.
Right.
And this just kind of came, as you were talking, this just kind of came to me. Put it to you this way.
Sure.
What if this is the order of the movie? You have that initial meeting.
Hold on. Before you say anything, because you obviously have what you think is the initial. Mm-hmm. Can I do mine to see if we're similar?
Go for it.
Okay, well, first thing I want to mention is that little sneak clip that they showed where Superman drops down, they bow, and he rips Bruce Wayne's
mask off.
One of two things, I think, on this one. One, that's either a dream, okay, because it looks like the same guys that are in the, where you see Apocalypse flying troops, which a lot of people are saying that's a dream. So a lot of those soldiers that are bowing down are in that scene, so I'm thinking maybe all that's a dream, right? Maybe. We'll see. Or number two, the reason they did that was because Superman already knew who Batman was, and they already talked with each other in the beginning of the movie, and that was actually to figure out where they're holding Clark's mom.
Yeah, I can see that.
So that's what I'm thinking for that particular scene. But what I'm thinking is, movie starts. Batman already knows who Superman is, right?
Because he's done the research. He's done the research.
He's figured it out. 2 + 2 added up for him, right?
He was like...
Because we already saw...
No, it's the same dude.
Oh, yeah. Because in the trailer, we see that he was already there during the destruction of Metropolis.
Yeah, so he was there.
He was there. He saw the buildings fall. Two years ago, three years ago. He held a girl in his hands. He's seen that. He's had all that time to prep, to figure out who this guy is, mm-hmm. how vulnerable he is. He knows who Superman is, right? So I'm thinking from the beginning of the movie, he knows who Superman is. Clark Kent meets Bruce Wayne. When I told you in the trailer, in the new trailer, they're having a discussion.
He definitely gives him a knowing smirk.
He gives him the look down when he says, like
he says, maybe it's just the Gotham and me. We don't like freaks dressed like clowns. And he kind of gives him this
and up and down, there's a smirk. So really? I feel like he definitely already knows, right? In one of the scenes, when he's got his armor off, Superman's bleeding. He holds him against the wall. Batman's holding Superman, ready to punch him. And you can see blood from Superman's face.
So kryptonite.
Clearly kryptonite. Clearly Batman's figured out that there is a source that can weaken him. Mm-hmm. That's all just beginning of the movie, right? Then Superman tells him, listen. Like, at some point, they patch it out, right? Because he tells him, if I wanted to, I could end you. Stop it, you know?
Stop it. He's just like, listen.
Like, if I wanted to, I could end you. And he could. Superman just doesn't do that. That's the thing. But then again, this is a different world, so they don't have to follow the comics. But
he'll snap his neck, too.
But I feel like at that point, Clark gets his beating from Batman because that's going to get that stress out of Batman's, you know, system. Or not stress, but that anger, right? That frustration. And I feel like by maybe 30% in, Superman's mom gets taken. And he goes to Batman and he's like, listen, I need your help. This is what's going on.
Okay.
And then from there, we see what unravels, like, okay, so the next part, they got to figure out where she is. I keep wanting to say Aunt May. Why is that stuck in my head? I'm not.
You're just really excited to see Marissa Tomei.
I'm saying, that's what it is, man. Thank you! You know, that's a whole different conversation. But I think the first 30% is maybe them hashing it out. I think by 30%, we see the next part of it where we see, okay, Superman lets Batman know, listen, I'm not bowing to Lex because of this. He has somebody I love. I need to find out where she is. Or I need to figure out, maybe he already knows, but I need to figure out how to get her away from there safely, whatever it is, right? They talk it out, right? Real quick scene or whatever. Batman, obviously, he's Batman, so he figures out shit fast. By then, Lex finds out, okay, well, they're not going to do it. They're not going to end each other. I got a plan. Creates Doomsday. We see the first part of Doomsday, right? Where they fight him. I feel like Superman, Batman, they end him. Maybe even her, but then we will see a second aspect of Doomsday. I think we'll see him, like, where he gets a second part to him with all the bones, too. Which I don't care either way. I'm perfectly fine with how Doomsday looked in the trailer. If that's how he looks, cool. Like, if that's how he looks from here on out...
I think it's fine.
Fine. Guys, calm the fuck down, alright? I'm sorry, but, like, doesn't have to be from the pages of the freaking book.
Right.
It's very close. I mean, it's for... Besides not having all the bones sticking out, it's very close.
Yeah.
So I don't know what else people want. I mean, he's huge, he's... bony, rocky, giant muscles, like, he looks like a freaking monster.
Right.
He's perfect. And then I feel like towards the end we'll see... So, obviously, they'll fight Doomsday. I think we might see Doomsday twice in the movie. I feel like we might see Doomsday fight twice.
I agree. And let me not tell you what I think the process is going to be. The progression.
Sure.
So I think... The first 30% or so is going to be, because it's, look at it this way, it's all dark, it's all nighttime, and so the little gala, the little ball that they're at is nighttime. Wonder Woman's there.
Yeah, she will be there because we saw it in the first trailer.
There's a first trailer where she comes out of the thing. So she's at that. Yeah. I think she's at that event.
Right.
Something brings out Superman and Batman. Mm-hmm. Some, they got to go and handle some shit.
Right.
And that's where they have where he's like coming at him with the jet, shooting at him. Yeah. And like, that's where I think we're going to have that, I can end you, stop this.
Yeah.
And that's when Doomsday shows up.
Right.
And
okay, and I see what you mean.
That's what that. So that's when an that huge explosion happens.
Sure.
And that's where Wonder Woman might even leave at that point.
Right.
She's like, "Hey, figure your shit out. I'm gonna go."
Hmm.
And then from there, the next section is gonna be that fight with the armor.
Right.
Because now he's like, "Listen, I can't take him." Right. Now we have this bigger problem of other things that might like he's the cause of this.
Right.
He's, maybe Batman figures out that that thing's based on Kryptonian DNA, so maybe he figures maybe it's based on Superman.
Yeah, absolutely.
So he's like, I gotta take care of this problem, makes the suit, goes, handles that, we have that fight, and then finally, because there is talk of there being some time travel involved with Ezra Miller's Flash, just kind of showing up either at the end or at some point. Yeah. So what I'm thinking, we might see like a possible future thing.
Now, once again, that's just speculation of Flash and
this is just talk.
That's completely rumor. There's nothing confirmed.
Nothing official. Please don't run with this, or do give us some hits, and then it'll be false. Right. I don't really care.
Yeah,
we've set our disclaimer.
Yeah,
but I'm thinking maybe it's not at the end. But at the end of that fight, it's like they're hashing it out. He comes back, and we see kind of a glimpse. And that's where that fight is with parademons and all that stuff.
Sure.
Because Darkseid is going to be in Justice League. They've said that.
Yeah, he's definitely going to be in there.
So it's from the future. He's basically coming from 2 years from now when the Justice League movie comes out. He's showing up. He's like, listen, you guys need to hash your shit out, because otherwise we're all fucked.
Because here's the thing.
And then we see Darkseid's second form, or Doomsday's second form, and the last part of the movie is them fighting together.
Here's the thing. If they did another Dream State, they did it in Man of Steel. There's no reason to do that again. Because they had a Dream State in Man of Steel.
What was the Dream State?
Where Zod is telling them that to join him, and then he sinks into the skulls. It's when he arrives on the ship and he's laying down. He like sinks into the human skulls because Zod is showing him that, he's explaining to him, join me, we're gonna make this the new Krypton. It's like, what do you have to do to make this the new Krypton? That's all a dream state. He's sleeping during that time. Zod is in his head. You don't remember
when? Was this in the theater?
It's on the DVD.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It's in the theater. Is that like an extra scene?
No. You don't remember when he sinks into the dead skulls of human beings?
Is this before he gets out of the ship? Before that, Jesus imagery where he falls out?
Yeah, because he has to wake up. You don't remember him being knocked out? Because he falls down. He realizes the ship weakens him. He falls, throws up, gets knocked out, then has the dream.
I don't remember that.
Yeah, it's okay. That's why I don't.
I genuinely don't remember that scene. I remember everything else. I remember Lois Lane on the ship. Yeah. I remember his father.
Yeah, I know.
Jor-El, Jesus.
I was like, did you want the real name? Or
Jor-El talking to Lois. Like, I remember all of that. But somehow I don't remember that. Weird. Very weird. But anyway, I'm not a fan of this theory where it's a nightmare. I say night because they said that it's the Batman suit in the toy is called Nightmare Batman with a K.
Right, sure.
I'm not a fan of that being an actual like dream sequence.
I hope
just
not.
Because what are these like, you know, parademon like creatures? Like, where is that imagery coming from in his head? Or is it maybe somebody? And I will accept it if it's information being piped to him from something else.
Right.
If somebody's giving him that imagery to incite him fighting Superman,
right,
I will accept that.
Sure.
But if it's just like him being like worried about it and that's what he dreams, I think that'll be dumb.
But that being said, I do want to put up on this. I think I want to add to your, you know, what you believe is going to happen. There's going to be a call. Batman's going to get the call. There's trouble. Superman's going to get the call. They're in the gala. And they're both going to find out that there's trouble at a specific location, probably set up by Lex. that's probably when we'll see the first part of Doomsday.
Sure.
The reason Batman shows up is because he didn't think Superman was going to be there. So Batman shows up without the suit. Because I think he already has the suit. I think he'll show up not thinking he needs the suit because it's just, you know, trouble he can handle.
Right.
Superman shows up. It was a hoax to get them together. They fight each other. Tells him, stop it, I can end this. And then we see another fight battle with them where Batman calls him out with his own signal. To get a kind of a rematch, right? And he's like, it's time for you to feel like a human. Gets his butt kicked.
He says, do you bleed?
Yeah, right? So, yeah, I agree. I think that's probably what we're going to see. But listen, regardless, super excited. Everybody's excited for this. I mean, dude, I don't think there's one person that once they heard Batman and Superman were going to be on the same screen, that they were like, tomorrow? Because I'll buy 50 tickets right now.
No, I'm way more excited about that than... I think that is also my number one
for next week. It's been so... It's been anticipated since... Since Superman became on the
Here's the thing. It's something that's... The concept of that fight and that pairing has existed since before my own... And my mother's existence.
I'm saying. So
like, it has existed since my grandmother... God rest her soul, right? Was a young woman.
I'm saying, like, so it's like...
That's how long that concept existed. So to see the culmination of decades of history...
Oh my God.
And the last two decades of technological advancement...
Absolutely.
To see that on screen, to see those two characters...
It's going to be...
I think it'll be fantastic.
Listen,
I am super, super excited.
Listen, first of all, for any of those people out there that watched Man of Steel and they're like... Oh my God, all that destruction or what it did, like no consequence. Listen, you think that was destruction. Batman, Wonder Woman, and Superman are about to fight Doomsday.
And they said Aquaman's going to be in it.
And Aquaman might be in it.
And they said Flash is going to be in it.
So listen, there's going to be all sorts of destruction in this movie.
I just want...
So if you can't get over it, sorry.
So I just want there to be one shot of the League. I love team comics.
Here's the thing. I don't think they're...
Because if there's time travel.
There might
I can see, like, mid-fight.
Here's the thing.
And he's just like, I gotta go, guys.
Here's the thing. That big explosion could shake the Earth just enough. Or not the Earth, but general location just enough to bother Aquaman in his water.
And he just shows up.
Yeah, he's just like listen, I'm sick of this bullshit.
He's like, guys, first it was for real?
First it was a year ago or whatever, or how long it's been since he fought Zod, and he felt that, right? And now Doomsday, and he's probably like, nope. He's like, listen, I'm sick and tired of it.
Oh, and you know what? This kind of goes back to an episode of Flash from last week, so if you didn't watch December 2nd?
I don't know, whatever. Last week's Flash.
December 1st and December 2nd's Flash, don't listen.
Yeah.
But, or Arrow, actually, because it was on the Arrow.
Yeah.
Because when that explosion, and it went out as a shockwave, it killed everyone, and he went back in time.
Yeah.
So what if that explosion is the future? Because that's a huge explosion.
That's a big explosion.
So that is not, the way they cut that in the trailer is not when Doomsday shows up. Because then I don't care about that little, the shield.
Right.
You all dead. I'm sorry.
That was a ginormous
The car would be exploded. Yeah. Batman would be just ashes.
But that being said, this is supposed to be a list of top 16.
So now
of
we're
our
gonna
most
do,
anticipated, so, not so, a conversation about every movie that what might happen in it.
So now we're gonna do. We're just gonna do a TLDR right here. So this is we're done for the major stuff. We're just gonna do a TLDR.
Well, let's do the TLDR after this next part. Because you want to do one more thing.
We've already pretty much had the discussions.
But not the discussion.
You just want me to challenge you on why you didn't put...
No, I thought you wanted to do that because we haven't really challenged each other on anything. You wanted specifically to challenge.
We talked... All
right, never mind.
We talked over an hour.
We were originally going to challenge each other on why maybe certain things weren't on our list. Oh, by the way, for honorable mentions as well, I forgot to say James got a gun... And
yeah, James
Gotta
Go
also 13 Hours by Michael Bay because I'm excited.
I'll definitely see 13 Hours. I'll definitely see it in a dollar theater because I remember the scenario, which was this was the Benghazi incident in 2012.
Right.
If any of you guys watched the news at all, you'll know what I'm talking about.
Or like anything.
No, really, like any source of media. Internet. if you existed in 2012 on the internet, were cognizant of the world, you understand what that's about. The trailer looks good, but the thing about it is, it really, if you shoved a bunch of just cuts from Transformers movies of the robots, it would look just like a Transformers trailer. And to me, I'm just not excited about that. I think it's just too many explosions.
Sure. But regardless, that's in my honorable mentions. But I'll see it. Yeah, let's do the TLDR.
Let's do a top five.
We'll do the 16. So whoever just wants to do here our top 16 without all right, hearing
so,
all that.
So here it is, TLDR top 16. My top 16: Deadpool, London Has Fallen, Batman v Superman, My Big Fat Greek Wedding 2, Captain America: Civil War, X Men Apocalypse, Now You See Me 2, Warcraft, Independence Day Resurgence, Knights of the Round Table, King Arthur, Star Trek Beyond, Suicide Squad, The Magnificent Seven, Doctor Strange, Assassin's Creed, and Jumanji. It's funny because a lot of those movies are sequels. Go on.
My top 16, no particular order except the last two. Assassin's Creed, Jack Reacher 2, Bourne 5, Star Trek Beyond, Knights of the Round Table, just like him, Warcraft, TMNT, Half Shell, X-Men Apocalypse, Snowden, The Huntsman, Winter's War, The Jungle Book, 999, Doctor Strange, Captain America: Civil War, number two, Deadpool, and number one, Batman v Superman.
Appreciate you guys for watching. If you are just watching the TLDR, you know, if you got some time, watch the other hour and a half of this.
If you want to hear more, then of course you've got to watch the other part of it.
But yeah, if you have any questions, what are your top 16 for 2016 movies?
Yeah, what are you
drop that down
about?
Below. We want to hear that. And, yeah, appreciate you guys for watching. Check out T3GTech.com. All that
still got stuff. A contest
We just crossed 400 subscribers, guys. Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you. Huge
love thanks. Doing this stuff. Love to see the people like watching it and enjoy partaking in this whole thing.
Partake.
So, yeah, drop down any comments, questions below. As always, I've been Dalibor.
Harris.
Signing off.
Yeah.